Welcome, my dear friends, masters and gods, and all the beautiful souls who are aligned to this great channel, the Pyramid Meditation Channel in English. We take pleasure in continuing our spiritual wisdom, magnificent spiritual wisdom offered by Harold Baldwin Percival from his book Thinking and Destiny. As we all know, this book is unique in many respects. And one of the reasons the book has really been considered very important and as a Bible of spirituality is because it contains all the wisdom that has not yet been made available by any other spiritual author. No wonder our Brahmarshi Patriji, who picked up this book almost 20 years back, calls it a book of the century. So, Patriji, who has read over 1 lakh spiritual books, when he gives a comment, it deserves all the attention and all our action by means of going in for this wisdom from this book and learning what best could be learned. The unique quality of this book is it has taken almost 30 years to write this book, and Percival has gathered all the wisdom possible, but it has not come out of any other spiritual masters or any other organizations, and all this has been done through messages which he has received from the astral masters. Thinking and Destiny was not developed as speculation nor to repeat and synthesize the ideas of others. It was written as a way for Percival to make known what he learned after being conscious of ultimate reality. As to the source and authority for the book, Percival clarifies that, and that too in one of his notes, that are the statements in Thinking and Destiny given as revelation from a deity or as a result of ecstatic states and visions, or have they been received while in trance under control or other spiritualistic influence, or have they been received and given as coming from some master of wisdom? To all of this, there is only one answer, which he emphatically says as no. Then why and on what authority do I say they are true? That is the next question. The authority is in the reader. He should judge as to the truth of the statements herein by the truth that is in him. The information is what he has been conscious of in his body, independently of anything he has heard or read, and of any instruction he has received from any source other than what is herein recorded and then put into black and white. So it is so very clear about what the book is and the source from which the knowledge is received. So this book represents a towering accomplishment in revealing the true state and potential of the human being. So friends, I am S.K.Rajan, Vice Chairman of the Indian Federation of Spiritual Scientists, an organ of the PSSN, and I am accompanied by Brahma Vidvarishta Girija Rajan and Purnima, who is a tarot card reader and a past life therapist. They would be offering their comments in the course of the reading, from which we take the essential message conveyed by Brahmarshi Patriji, because he has culled out the messages from the book Thinking and Destiny. So we pay our tribute to two great masters. One is Percival for his wisdom, and one is Brahmarshi Patriji for having selected this book to convey to us, to give us this knowledge. Today's topic is money, and as we all know, money is also considered as energy. So let us see what Percival has to say on money and how, as human beings here on this earth, how we give the attention to it or the priority to it, or whether it is linked to spirituality. These are all matters which will come in the course of the reading, and we have to evolve from it after the reading. The subject of money and what has monetary value deserves special attention. The possession and the lack of money create today the 1001 conditions through which the ways of destiny lead. Independence, servitude, fatigue, checks on development, choice of associates, power, opportunity, duty, most of the innumerable predetermined aspects of life in the world are related to money. Everybody needs money. It is proper that everybody should have some. Indeed, one of the tests of a good government is that all people under it should have the opportunity to earn enough for food, clothes, and shelter. Beyond these needs, some wants are justifiable according to the position a man holds in the world. If one has no wife or children, less is needed. But the thoughts of man go beyond and demand not only what would be sufficient for their needs and reasonable wants. They want money for luxury and display, for power over others, and some want money for money's sake. However much they may have, they still want more.
Hello friends. So Percival here has told us something about money. So money is a material wealth that is the whole world is running on money. Without money, we couldn't have done anything here. So that is what he's trying to say. Everything runs on money. Everyone has to have a little bit, at least up to the extent they can have or they can find themselves comfortable. But beyond that, I think it is not required. He will go on to say that the coming paragraphs, but here he says how much ever one has, they are not contented with it. They want to go on for acquiring more and more of material wealth, which will actually lead them again to ignorance and again to that darkness or whatever you might call it. They might not find themselves more conscious. The dua path gets totally involved in the material world, so they'll not be able to get that liberation. And that is what I would like to inferred from this paragraph.
Yeah, this is really an interesting subject, because everyone wants to know what this great magic wand that is called as money. Because definitely the material world is based on the system called monetary system. Yes, definitely. Because we need it in our day-to-day life. Yes, even a spiritual person who practices spirituality needs money. He may not have a rupee in his pocket, but he needs others' help, because to run the daily life, yes, we do need it. So we have formed this system in such a way that a person who has enough money can have the basic necessities of life, food, shelter, and clothing. These are very basic. Yeah, the government should be in such a way that it sees to it that all the persons, all the citizens of that nation, they do have this primary necessities fulfilled. But the man's thinking doesn't stop at that. He wants more. He wants more. Everyone wants more. More than what he has got in hand. Nobody is satisfied. There, the spiritual person and the ordinary person who is non-spiritual, who is more material, there the difference comes. The spiritual person is satisfied. Today, it is finished, it's over. Tomorrow, what happens? Who knows? So he leaves it like that. So he is seldom affected by the term called money. Whereas the ordinary person is definitely, he is worried because he has to take care of his family. The basic amenities are not given to him. So like that it goes on. So definitely man needs money. But sometimes this money is a very intriguing, or what to say, sort of a blurred affair, that it doesn't give you the clarity so for a material person. Because we keep on increasing our necessities as we happen to earn it. And we earn to have the necessities, for having the necessities we earn. So it becomes a treadmill existence. According to Linda Goodman, we most of 90% of the population of the world, it is the money, place, makes the life as a treadmill existence. We just go to work for the sake of getting things. To get things, we go to work. Like that, we need the things for going to work. Like that, it is a treadmill. No? For this, you have to do that. For to get that, you have to do this. Like that, it alternates and it makes our life a treadmill existence here. So, what Percival comes to say is, we should exactly understand what money is. Why is it needed? How to come out of the term money so that we can live, we can get more freedom. As Purnima has rightly said, yes, the person finally has to have more freedom. So for that freedom, how to come out of the term money? Of course, we need money. Only up to the hands it must come. It should not get into our heads. That is what I said by many masters. They have said like that. And we'll see more of what Percival has to say about money.
Often, money, after it has been acquired, has little value. It will not buy health, honor, self-respect. It cannot buy love, nor life, nor independence, ease, or knowledge. True independence is what money should help to bring, and little money is enough for that. Though independence varies with one's position and work in the world, little money is needed to establish it. Cares, troubles, and intrigues surround those who desire more than enough. Money does not enlarge the range of independence. Happiness within and assurance without is what all men want. But life never gives them. The nearest approach is independence, however modest it may be. Money is one of the smallest requirements. The less one needs and the less he wants from the money god, the more independent that one is.
So friends, so beautifully he has put it. So there are so many things money cannot buy. We cannot get honor, respect, or self-respect with money. So nor health. So all this is other than, it is not bought by money. So we have to understand the limitations of this energy. So we should have this energy to the optimum level. Man actually needs freedom and happiness, and that is only got through knowing more of ourselves and being more conscious of ourselves, rather than money or material things. So we have to have a line drawn as to where we have to put a stop to getting and getting more money, or we should know our we should actually know where to stop. So that is what we have to learn from this para. I feel the message is we should know where to stop, and we should use it wisely. So that is what Percival is trying to say here.
Yeah, definitely this term money is very abstract, and we are unable to understand it, and we are unable to handle it. The population, entire population of the world, in that only few have come to know about money and how to handle it. As Purnima has said, it's not only enough to enough if you earn loads of money, but it is also the way in which we spend it. The wisely spent money is always for the better. So we should all know all these things. So Percival has put it very, very beautifully that all the things in life are not bought by money. We know that. So it's only certain things can be bought by money. So it is not all powerful. Money is not all powerful as we think. There are persons who are worth the least of money but the best of happiness. So what man needs is inner happiness, outer security. So those things are really assured only by going within and taking to a spiritual path. And spiritual practices definitely give us the assurance that we need from the outside world and the inner happiness. As I remember the great author Michael Nemi, who has written the book of Mirdad. In that he has written that the more we possess, the less we are assessed in the other worlds. So the less we possess here, the more we are assessed, and the more we possess, the less we are assessed there. So if you want to be assessed in a higher way or assessed better, then definitely our possessions here should be the least. So the minimum that we need. So when we understand for what purpose we have come here, and without fulfilling that purpose, we have to keep on coming here, birth after birth, and time will be spent unnecessarily. So we should think of that, look, sit down, be still, and then think of all that, why ever we have come here. So we should put that purpose into action, take it into our lives, and then fulfill that purpose for which we have come. Instead, we get entangled in some other things and the time is lost. So again, we have to come back to learn so many things. So it is better we finish off our syllabus first and know our purpose of life. Unless we turn our attention on spirituality, this is not going to happen. So now, at this era, at this stage, a great master has been sent by the heavenly masters, who have sent us this great master, Brahma Shri Pita Mahapatriji, here onto this earth to tell each and everyone that enough is enough. Now it is time to take to spiritual practices, turn to spirituality as a goal in your lives. So such an excellent master is here who teaches everything. So we'll keep on hearing him and rectify ourselves and lead an excellent life to our own satisfaction. That doesn't mean that we should not have money, we should not enjoy the luxury. Yes, you can enjoy everything, but everything has got a limit. But at the same time, you should be spiritually evolved. That is also, spiritual evolution is also a great lesson that we have to take up. That's a very great purpose for which we have come over here. So that should be in mind. Whatever life we lead, that purpose should be very much concrete in our system, and also we should be aware of it. So if you live such a life, yes, definitely the life will be more meaningful, more contented, more helpful to others, or helpful in the way it will set an example for others. So definitely it pays.
Less possessed is more assessed in the astral worlds. So the best example for this, I would say, is I remembered our ex-president, Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam. He was so very simple. If we read about him and get to know more about him, he had very limited material possessions, and he used to invest his time more on the intellectual part. And I was really wonderstruck when I got to know that he had very minimum possessions of his own. So that is what I wanted to tell here. So really we remember him now, and really hail unto Dr. APJ Abdul Kalam.
Friends, I would like to supplement what these two speakers have told. In a sense, this para which we have just read has initially indicated that true independence is what money should help to bring, and for this, that much money is sufficient. So we have to remember, it is not important that we should accumulate more and more than what is actually required by us to exist on this earth. It is enough if you are able to get the independence that everyone aspires for. So, for which you don't need that much of money. So, if you are able to preserve your independence, there is nothing more to it, there is nothing more important than that. So, money cannot give you anything else. Even health depends upon your own karma. So, money cannot give you health, money cannot give you self-respect, honor, etc. So, it is enough if you are able to preserve our independence until our last breath. So, off to I go to the next para. The money god is a powerful earth spirit, created, kept alive and given his power, like other gods, by the worship of the dua portions in human bodies. Under this great earth god are little money gods, special deities for each of the worshippers. Each little money god in the heart and on the earth is nourished by the worshipper and stands for the great god. The individual gods pass the worship on to the composite great god. This one in turn, through the hierarchy, aids his worshippers in obtaining money and avoiding losses, in helping them into successful enterprises and lucrative positions, or in keeping them out of financial disasters. But this god cannot give health, comfort or esteem, nor love, cheer or hope, nor can it give protection in the end when destiny cannot be held back. Often, a worshipper, having obtained the money, worships other gods and uses the money to gratify other desires which his wealth permits. The money god is tolerant while he holds the first place in the heart. But if the new worship, such as that of voluptuousness, drunkenness and ambition, interferes, he is a jealous god and revenges himself not only by the loss of money, but by the loss of the things that the same money has bought.
So, Percival here says that there is a money god that all the people generally worship, and under the great money god there are other smaller gods. He says this money god is a nature spirit. It's not the higher form of the triune self. Compared to the triune self, it's a lesser in degree of consciousness, or I would say it is a nature spirit. So that's what Percival has also told. So people worship that smaller gods and get the things, material abundance through the worship. So, and these smaller gods move on to give the greater money god the energy that the people are feeding. So that is what Percival is trying to say here. So, and as in when they worship, they all the material abundance is bestowed upon these people. And one other thing Percival has told here is he has told, if we are spending our time in drinking and spending more of time in unwanted, unnecessary activities, then the money god will take a revenge, and all the losses and all the misfortunes will come upon that person who takes to all these unnecessary activities. So that is what Percival is making a point here. So I think I hope it's clear to you.
Yeah, this is very excellent, that there is a god, money god, created by man, not anybody else. The doer in the body creates this money god. For everything else also there are money gods, and there are subdivisions in that section. For abundance in this area, this department, there is another smaller god. in another department there is another smaller god. Like that, every department has got regarding money, there are several departments and there are several gods to that. So they are all fed by the man who worships them or the doer who worships. So the worship is the food for that god. So like that it goes on. So until we realize that this is not, this is only a creation that we have done, a mental creation, that is our imagination. Along with nature, we have created this god, and the all-powerful, almighty is somewhere else. It is the triune self along with the light of intelligence that has created the entire thing, and all that we see, the whole cosmos is filled with that energy, filled with that consciousness. That is what we have to understand. Without that understanding, we'll keep on like this. And as Purnima has rightly said, the money, what it does is, this money, if we earned in the wrong way or in more than what is needed, in amounts which are more than what is needed by a person, then it leads us to all other activities like drinking. People take to drinking and other activities because that is not at all good for them. But the money is driving them to do that. That is what another aspect of money. Of course, money purchases all the material wealth, material comforts. But at the same time, it can also drag a person into all this, what we call as vices. So it is possible that a man gets entangled in all these things. Then when once he goes behind the vices and he is involved more in that activity, then definitely the gods will not be happy with him. They take away all the wealth and he will meet with losses and so many other things. We have seen, even in pictures, cinemas, we have seen the hero goes like that and gets involved in vices. He'll become a rich person and gets involved in vices, and thereby he loses everything. His honor, everything is lost. So like that, of course, again, life will again bloom and it will teach him a lesson, and then he'll come back. There's no doubt. But the time is lost. So much of time is lost in all these things. So beforehand, if we know that we have to possess only what is needed by us, that is what is essential, so that all the people in the whole of the world will be able to live a comfortable life. If a person starts hoarding what is due for others, then that becomes a poison for himself. That is what Percival wants to say. Patriji goes on to another degree of explanation. He has told that the money god, which is worshipped as Lakshmi Devi in our in Indian culture, Hindu, that is in Hindu religion, that goddess is not money actually. What he says is that is only service. So service to mankind is service to God. So when we do service, by way of so many service, in many ways we can serve humanity. So when service comes first, then money can be earned through that. Definitely we learn so many friends. That is the real earning. So through service we earn friends, and friends in turn definitely will help us at the time of need. Then there is no need to run behind money. So if you do service itself, the earning is already done. So like that, we have to lead a life full of service to others that we like. The other person, we service in the sense that we help others to help themselves. We are not going to help them directly. We will only allow them to help themselves. That is how, or show the path to them. That is the greatest service that we have to do. And that is the Lakshmi God. Lakshmi Devi, we always think that it is full of gold coins, full of wealth and all those things. But not like currency notes. No, not at all like that. There is definitely service that is behind the money that earns us money. If ever a person is wealthy and rich in this dharma, in this incarnation, then it means that he has done so much of service in past lives. The thought in the past life has given this destiny to him. There is a very good destiny to enjoy wealth. But again, if he has to continue this, he has to see that it is put to very wise use and use to others, then definitely it will sustain all the time. And never take to vices. That is how it is explained by Percival.
Percival has mentioned is the money god cannot, if you worship the money god, it won't give you love, respect, hope or cheer. So all these things are definitely not, we won't get that from this god, is what Percival has told.
Yeah, yes, definitely. Now I also remember one more point. That is, you cannot get your life extended because of money. So if you tell somebody, if you tell the doctor, doctor, I'll pay you 1 crore rupees, a person on the deathbed, give me some few months, 6 months of life. No, it is not possible. It is not possible to extend life at all. But it is possible for a guru to extend. The external guru with in conjunction with the internal guru. That is, our internal guru is our breath. So breath is the life-giving force, energy, we all know that. So with that, the two gurus will can only extend our lives. Nobody else, no other energy or force or power is there to extend our lives at all. So that is what he again emphasizes. So it is now time for everyone to think over and put a full stop to taking to middle path whenever money comes. The grand middle path that is suggested by our great Lord Buddha. So we have to consider all the points, then lead such a life. We have to bring it to practice into our daily life. Then only it helps. So
The external guru only shows the path. It doesn't actually come in extending your life. He shows you the path, gives you the right books, as Patriji has given us. So that will lead us to enlightenment, and that extends our life.
If there is a purpose for us in this life, the guru knows. If I have to do, suppose like in the case of a very great spiritual master, Lobsang Rampa, his external guru, he extended his life because he knew that Lobsang Rampa needed to write 3 more books that will enlighten so many people, that will really clear so many doubts in the minds of people, and definitely that will help people grow in spirituality. So because of that, his life was extended by his guru. Outside guru will extend because the guru knows very well the purpose is not yet complete. So let us give him some more time so that he completes the purpose. That is how it is done. So nothing else, no other force, not even money, can purchase any crores of rupees you give. You cannot extend it by even 1 minute, our life here on this earth. That is a very important underlying aspect, or a very great truth that has been revealed by Percival. Thanks to Percival.
So friends, we have considered a short note on what money is and how money is being acquired, etc. But this would not suffice, and we will continue in the next episode all the aspects regarding money, especially why man is born in poverty, and why and what could be done to overcome the poverty, and what are the real priorities in life. At this moment, I am reminded of what Adi Shankara said in his great epic, great masterpiece, Bhajagovindam. Nitya Anitya Viveka Vichara. This is what is required by the average human being. You have to do Nitya Anitya means temporary and permanent. Vichara means thinking. So you have to differentiate between what is wealth, temporary and permanent, and what is the priority required? That is Viveka Vichara. Viveka Vichara means the highest of thinking. Your thinking should be in the highest level so that you are able to differentiate between what is temporary wealth and what is permanent wealth. So what can stand you until the last breath? That is permanent wealth.
Even after.
But what and thereafter? And what goes away unpredicted and comes and goes, that is unpredictable. So that is only temporary wealth. But permanent wealth is all experience and knowledge. These are the two great things which we have to gather when we are on this earth. So we cannot afford to forget what Adi Shankara has said, That is Nitya Anitya Viveka Vichara. This is what we should go after, and this is what should be the ultimate possessions that we have in while we are on this earth. With these words, I stop here with today's episode, but we will continue the remaining portions of what wealth is and how it can be stored and what are our duties in regard to this money mystic and green energy, which is nothing but money and wealth. Thank you, thank you, thank you. Thanks to Poonima and Girija Rajan.
Thank you.
Thank you.